thank you so much for joining me today for my presentation on Leon McAuliffe, the so-called retirement of a steel guitar king. For about a half a century, Leon McAuliffe was a familiar face in Northwest Arkansas and even a resident for about 20 of those years. Whether he was a guitarist for Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys or leading his own band, the Cimarron Boys. He was also owner of Rogers' first radio station, KAMO, and chances are if there was a festival and it involved a chicken, Leon McAuliffe was the designated entertainment. And here's a picture, not the best quality, of a street dance in 1951 at the Fayetteville Square for Chicken of Tomorrow Week. And that was a huge gathering that featured Leon McAuliffe included, and the event included a chicken breeding competition between poultry farmers. And this is kind of a big deal because it was United States Vice President Alvin Barkley spoke at the National Chicken of Tomorrow contest. And of course, a large street dance was part of the festivities. And you can see in this photo that ran in the Northwest Arkansas Times, they reported that thousands of people attended. And if you look at that photo, no doubt, and they were all there to see Leon McAuliffe. And if you look in the background, I'm pretty sure that's the old First National Bank building on the corner of Block and Center Street. And then there's the Decatur Barbecue, another chicken event. And that was in Benton County, where Leon McAuliffe and the Cimarron Boys performed every year from 1953 to 1972. And one of the things Leon might have done was crown the young lady who would be designated as Miss Barbecue. But I want to stress that he was so much, much more than some of these events that where he performed. And one of the most important things he did was record and write the song Steel Guitar Rag, which he recorded with Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys in 1936. And it was the beginning of the evolution of the popular phrase that Bob Wills used to call out to Leon, "Take it away, Leon." That phrase stuck with Leon McAuliffe for the rest of his life. And here's a sample of Steel Guitar Rag. And I wanna make sure that we have audio. So please let me know if we don't. Leon,
take it away, boys, take it away.
Whoops, here we go, let's try again.
Look out, friends, here.
Oops, and it's getting away from me.
Look out, friends, here's Leon. Take it away, boys, take it away. Everybody dance now. Swinging, Mr. Leon.
Oops, sorry. I'll try again. This thing is just getting away from me, and I knew this would happen. All right, one last time, my apologies.
Friends, here's Leon. Take it away, boys, take it away. Everybody dance now. Swinging, Mr. Leon, swinging.
And the other important song that Leon wrote and recorded was Panhandle Rag, which he did in 1949 after leaving Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys. The song soon became one of those traditional tunes to be played on steel guitar, much like Orange Blossom Special is for the fiddle. This song, as noted on the screen, made it to number 14 for folk records, as the term really, country music really had not come in play yet. And here's a sample of this song. All right, here we go. And Leon McAuliffe was also a huge inspiration to other musicians. One of them was Don Helms, a steel guitarist for Hank Williams. When Don Helms died in 2008 at the age of 81, his obituary in the New York Times noted that when Helms was a boy growing up in Alabama, he was a fan of Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys, most notably Leon McAuliffe. As a result, he took up the steel guitar at the age of 15 and later joined Hank Williams's band. And here's Helm's steel guitar opening to a very famous Hank Williams song. And the sound caught on like wildfire. Here's an introduction to a famous 1952 Kitty Wells song. It's performed by steel guitarist Shot Jackson, as shown here.
As I sit here tonight, the jukebox playing.
Okay, so let's fast forward a little bit. It is now 1969 and the steel guitar has evolved. If you notice in this picture of Pete Drake, there's pedals with the steel guitar, and that enabled the strings to be bent more and manipulated more. And that was kind of the future of the steel guitar. And so he plays, even though he was a country music musician, Bob Dylan wanted to perform with him or wanted to record with him, however. So he played the introduction to this very famous Bob Dylan song. So, in short, all of these songs feature a steel guitar that contains a twang that can be traced back to Leon McAuliffe, but it also can be traced back to one other musician that I'll mention in a few minutes. This presentation is titled The So-Called Retirement of a Steel Guitar King for a Reason. Leon McAuliffe's journey as a retiree took a life of its own and one that I found inspiring. And it's not necessarily a story about McAuliffe, but a whole group of older men, some of whom left their careers in music, and then they were back in demand with McAuliffe leading the way. I don't think it was something that even Leon McAuliffe could have envisioned. But before we talk about Leon McAuliffe's so-called retirement, we first have to talk about his background and what it was that he so-called retired from. William Leon McAuliffe was born on January 3rd, 1917 in Houston, Texas. His parents divorced at a young age, and he lived with his mother, who bought him his first guitar for $7 at a pawn shop. He was obsessed with it and took guitar lessons, but he was so skilled at learning, he ended up teaching himself more songs once he mastered what he was taught that week. He would also visit musicians and learn from books to the point that he could play professionally. He performed on the radio, which gave him free advertising, and it led him to play professionally. He got gigs at private parties and dances, and he dropped out of high school, and apparently that was not a big concern to his mother. If you have to bear in mind, this was during the Great Depression, and Leon had steady work. And another thing Leon was doing was perfecting his guitar style. At the time, Hawaiian music was really popular, and even Bing Crosby got on the bandwagon. One of the main characteristics of Hawaiian music is steel guitar. Leon could get a similar sound to the Hawaiian guitar by loosening his strings and placing a nut, as in like a nut and bolt, the nut, and he put it underneath the strings and it would raise them up. And if he got like a metal bar or like a bottleneck, he could slide up and down the guitar neck, and that would give it its distinctive sound. Up the road in Fort Worth was a popular regional band by the name of Light Crust Doughboys, who performed on a local radio station as ambassadors to Light Crust Flour. In 1933, a group of musicians who played there, including a man named Bob Wills, who we've already talked about, he left to create his own band, leaving a few vacancies. McAuliffe, who was then 16, was hired as a replacement, getting paid $10 a week. And even back then, that was not really good money. And he knew it. He dropped out of the band at one point, but his mother urged him to stay in because she knew that would be good exposure. And so he did it. And years later, he told people he was so glad he listened to his mother. And one thing that's important to note, as I mentioned earlier, is that we can't give full credit to Leon McAuliffe for pioneering the direction of the steel guitar alone, though he was the one who was probably best associated with it. We also need to talk about this man right here, Bob Dunn, who played lap steel guitar for Milton Brown and his musical Brownies. Before then, he also played with the Light Crust Doughboys and was a huge inspiration to Leon. Dunn played steel guitar with an electrical device known as a pickup to give his guitar amplification, When he went on to perform with Milton Brown and his musical Brownies, a Western swing band, it's quite possible that Dunn would have been the one to gain all the glory for this new distinctive way of playing the guitar, had it not been for one thing. And that was that his band leader, Milton Brown, was killed in an automobile accident in 1936. And Bob Dunn was never able to align with a band that was as popular as the Texas Playboys. When Bob Wills left the Lightcrust Doughboys, he wanted to provide music with a Western slant that served as alternatives to the popularity of what was called hillbilly music back during that time. Back then, if you listened to the Carter Family, Uncle Dave Macon and such, it was either listed as folk, hillbilly, or maybe even Western if it was more of a cowboy bent. Bob Wills played the fiddle, but he wanted it to swing. Drums and horns, which were associated with jazz, were added to fiddles and guitars. This allowed for the group to have a versatile playlist and included jazz and blues, as well as songs that, yes, at times might have veered more towards the hillbilly realm. They had no way of knowing it at the time, but their use of an electric guitar, bass, and drums created the foundation of rock and roll, though the term of this genre would become known as Western swing, with Bob Wills knighted as its king. During the band's infancy, Bob Wills lost his original steel guitarist, and he was already aware of Leon McAuliffe. He sent a representative to Fort Worth to lure Leon away with the offer of $30 a week, which is like three times the amount Leon was making with the Lightcrust Doughboys. And that's all it took. Leon headed to Tulsa and was now a member performing with the band as representatives of Playboy Flower and performed on the air on Tulsa Radio KBOO, which that could be heard in Northwest Arkansas. And Bob Wills had a radio show during the noon hour, which meant when people were eating their lunch, or I think in the South we say dinner, they would sometimes maybe tune in to Bob Wills and listen to him on KBOO. And as a member of the Lightcrust Doughboys, McAuliffe on occasion played an amplified guitar owned by Bob Dunn. Now with the Texas Playboys, Leon suggested to Wills that he would like to play an electric steel guitar, much like he had learned from Bob Dunn. And Bob Wills thought that was a pretty good idea, so he went to the music store and paid $180 cash for the guitar, and had to be special ordered. This instrument was so new. And I absolutely love this photo of Leon right here. I mean, he looks so young, and you got to love those cowboy boots with the stars. I mean, he just, to me, looks like a young man who's just getting ready to embark on a great journey. And here they are again, and Leon is on the far right. And it's also interesting to note that they weren't really dressing in Western gear. They're dressed more like a jazz band in many ways. And not long after Leon joined Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys, they were frequently performing in the region, including Northwest Arkansas. The Fayetteville paper reported and advertised their performances frequently. In fact, they were regular performers for the local chapter of the Disabled American Veterans Association. They played countless times in 1935 and 1936 at what is then the National Armory, shown here. And the building still exists. It's right between the old Washington County Courthouse, and on the right is the old American Legion building. I don't know if carrying caskets is still there, but this is like one of those shrines to me. Every time I drive by there, I just think about how Bob Wills used to play there. And when they performed a May 3rd, 1935 show, the Fayetteville Daily Democrat newspaper noted that the band members were registered at the Washington Hotel on the Fayetteville Square. And here are some of the places that Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys performed, such as the now long gone Lake Francis Resort south of Siloam Springs. That's a fascinating place to me. The Legion Hut in Fayetteville. And I believe that was the building to the right that we just saw of the National Guard Armory. And of course, the National Guard Armory itself, where this advertisement noted the Yale Centennial. And what that was, they had a celebration for the 100th anniversary when Archibald Yale, who was a Fayetteville resident, announced his candidacy for governor. And he did become the state's second governor. So I guess back in the day, that was really, really a big deal to celebrate it. By the early 1940s, Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys were now becoming national stars and headed out to California to make Westerns. Leon went along just to make the movies, though he didn't move there. He stayed in Tulsa, where he was now married to his wife, Lucille. And the movie, Take Me Back to Oklahoma, which was starred Tex Ritter, played at the Palace Theater on the Fayetteville Square. And this advertisement caught my attention because if you look at the ad, on the corner of the bottom left, it says, "And our own Texas Playboys." And that's pretty telling because, for one, you knew they played here an awful lot. And two, they played so frequently. It was like, if you lived here, they were one of our own. And Leon McAuliffe, he didn't just play the steel guitar, but he had a really great singing voice and even sang lead in this segment from this 1943 film titled Saddles and Sagebrush. And Leon is 26 years old here, and he's in the left of the screen.
Chin that fiddle and make it sing, chin that fiddle and make it sing, chin that fiddle and make it sing, sing that toodle-umbo. Rag back the other way, toodle-umbo, rag back the other way, toodle-umbo, rag back the other way, toodle-umbo, sing that toodle-umbo.
However, World War II was looming, and Leon Wills and others joined the military for the war effort in 1943. Leon signed up for the Navy, and one thing I have yet to mention is that Leon, up until the time that he joined the Navy, had been taking flight lessons and knew how to fly a plane. He was assigned the role of flight instructor for the Navy before serving active duty, and meanwhile, he took his steel guitar with him and accompanied bands at naval stations. At one point, he became a member of the naval band led by fellow sailor Tex Beneke, who just also happened to be the saxophonist for Glenn Miller and his orchestra, a very popular band back then. Leon McAuliffe's experience with Tex Beneke changed the direction he wanted to go with music. When he was discharged from the Navy, Leon had already decided to end his career with Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys. In fact, he even decided to end his career with Western Swing. Instead, he wanted a big band orchestra, and he wanted it to be in Tulsa. He told the Tulsa World in 1946, "No more Western bands for me. I'm going to give Tulsans something new, a really high-class dance orchestra." In fact, he even brought his dance orchestra to the Legion Hut in Bentonville, and as was the case at first, people were excited to see the famous steel guitarist from the Texas Playboys. However, they quickly became bored with the big band orchestra, which contained some of the former members of the Texas Playboys, because they wanted to hear San Antonio Rose and some of the other songs for which Leon had made famous. So Leon's venture into big band music lasted only a few months before he switched back to Western Swing. And this is also right around the time that he made the switch that he had a hit song with the Panhandle Rag, which I played for you earlier. And Leon McAuliffe was a popular attraction in himself. And in 1950, he purchased the Akhtar Temple Theater in downtown Tulsa. He converted the building into a performance venue and dance hall that he renamed the Cimarron Ballroom. And for years to come, this was home base for Leon McAuliffe and the group's radio show, which aired on KVOO, the same station that featured the Texas Playboys, which meant people in Northwest Arkansas were still listening to Leon McAuliffe on the radio. And as you can see, the venue was really a show place, an attraction, no less, and it could be a fancy place to take your date, and you could even buy a program, a souvenir book, just to remember what a great time you had. And Leon brought the big names in. Well, maybe he didn't succeed as a big band orchestra. He didn't stop for bringing the big names in. So look at these ads. You have Duke Ellington, Harry James, Jimmy Dorsey, Stan Kenton, Woody Herman, and all of these musicians are household names. And there were plenty of big name country artists too, such as Jim Reeves, Brenda Lee, Don Gibson, Webb Pierce. And if you notice something, you'll see that Leon McAuliffe, he dropped the E at the end of his name. And he did this like around the 1950s and 1960s. And I don't know why that is. And I would love to know the story behind that. And speaking of country music artists, there was one person who was a huge fan of Leon McAuliffe, which stemmed for her love for Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys, and that would be legendary Patsy Cline, who performed on at least a couple of occasions at the Cimarron Ballroom. One of those shows occurred in 1961 after Cline was seriously injured from a car accident. Though she canceled all other performances following her accident, against her doctor's orders, she kept the one at the Cimarron Ballroom, her first public performance after her well-publicized car wreck, even though she was walking on crutches and the wounds on her face had not fully healed. A recording of the performance was discovered several years ago and was released on CD. In between songs, you can hear Leon making a request to Patsy Cline, and she responds with, "The boss just gave me an order. My, my. Well, I'll tell you one thing, honey child. You can boss me anytime you want. I'd like to work for him all the time. As I've told you before, this is the sweetest music this side of heaven. And that is just amazing to me. Patsy, that's how Patsy Cline felt about Leon McAuliffe and the Cimarron Boys. And one thing I haven't mentioned until this point was how unusual it was for a lap steel guitarist to lead an orchestra. Leon McAuliffe needed to be in front and center. So one thing he did was get a stand for his steel guitar so that he could stand in front of his orchestra. And he had to be on the move. He had to direct his orchestra, then maybe run over to the microphone to sing, and then swiftly go back to his steel guitar to play a solo. And here is an example, which is towards the end of the performance, and McAuliffe is singing New San Antonio Rose, which, by the way, New San Antonio Rose is San Antonio Rose with lyrics. And with him is fiddler Keith Coleman, who is impersonating Bob Wills. And another thing that's fun about this video is he's doing his best to get Leon McAuliffe to laugh. I apologize for the audio.
Broken song, empty words, I know, still live in my heart, hollow. But that moon that passed by the Alamo, rose by rose of San Antonio.
And meanwhile, Leon McAuliffe already had a business interest in Northwest Arkansas, namely KAMO Radio, which became Rogers, Arkansas's first radio station, a combined effort between Leon and his manager, G. Don Thompson, who had some broadcasting experience. Thompson had worked in television while in Tulsa. Of course, this was big news in 1954, and there was even a groundbreaking ceremony midway between Bentonville and Rogers, the newspaper noted, where they built a 300-foot tower. The call letters for KAMO stood for Kansas, Arkansas, Missouri, and Oklahoma for the station's broadcast range. Its first broadcast took place on September 16, 1954. Smokey Dacus, who incidentally was the first drummer for Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys, was hired as disc jockey and eventually became station manager. And like Smokey had left Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys probably shortly right before Leon McAuliffe did. So now Leon McAuliffe, in addition to G. Don Thompson, knew somebody else in Rogers, and that would be Smokey Dacus. And the studio for the radio station KAMO was first located upstairs at 114 South First Street, in Rogers. It also sponsored concerts at the nearby Victory Theater, including this one by the Bill Black Combo. And I know Conway Twitty and Ferlin Husky, a whole slew of people performed there that KAMO brought in. And I also read an account that on at least one occasion, Bob Wills visited the studio, the door that's in the center of the two other buildings. It would be upstairs is what I understand. Excuse me. Leon also kept performing. He had countless performance dates when he wasn't at the Cimarron Ballroom, and even purchased his own plane, which he had Take It Away Leon painted on the nose of the plane. And though he's wearing cowboy clothes on these in these pictures, but there's a part of me that really hopes that maybe he dressed up like a cowboy when he flew his plane around, but I don't know. Leon, along with G. Don Thompson, launched the record label Cimarron Records. Leon even had a couple of top 40 country hits in the early 1960s. One of them was Cozy Inn, which led to a full-length album on the ABC Paramount record label that, curiously, featured very little steel guitar, perhaps in a move to sound more contemporary. That was kind of the sound, that smooth sound with Nashville strings like Patsy Cline and Jim Reeves were doing around that time. And that may have been the inspiration. You also notice that there's some familiar names to Northwest Arkansas on some of these records, such as Ben Jack, who had a small music store chain in the region, and the MCs, a popular Northwest Arkansas band. He also signed some well-known artists, including Floyd Tillman, who had already reached the peak in his career by this point, but is now, since then, has become an inductee of the Country Music Hall of Fame. Leon sold some of the Cimarron Records recordings to Starday Records in 1964. Leon had toured extensively and accomplished so much by now. But there were problems at home, and he and his wife were not getting along too well. And his wife of 28 years and the mother of his two children filed for divorce. So there were a lot of changes going on with Leon right now. And then here we are, Leon retires. With the divorce behind him, Leon moved to Rogers, and KAMO, which would have just been around the corner from this photo was taken, which I think is facing west on Walnut from the square. And KAMO would have been right around the corner. Leon also remarried around this time. Starting a new chapter, he could go fishing nearby at Beaver Lake, play golf. He could go fishing nearby at Beaver Lake, play golf, visit his old buddy and bandmate, Smokey Dacus, at the radio station. And here's a fun fact. In 1962, as Apollo 12 orbited the moon, the astronauts blasted the music New San Antonio Rose, a song that Leon co-wrote. And meanwhile, there was something else going on. And it was these guys. They may have sung country music, but they defied Nashville and the direction country music was taking and would be known as country music outlaws. And they all had one thing in common. They grew up listening to Bob Wills, who was their hero. And Bob wasn't doing that well anymore. In 1969, Wills had a stroke that left him partially paralyzed and threatened the future of the Texas Playboys. Merle Haggard, who had by now had hits with Okie from Muskogee and The Fight Inside of Me, learned to play fiddle just so he could record a tribute album with some of the band's members, though Leon McAuliffe and Smokey Dacus were not among them. However, another country music outlaw, Tompall Glaser, did hire Leon for a recording of Faded Love, which was first popularized by the Texas Playboys. And it actually made the country music charts in 1971. And you can see Leon McAuliffe's name in fine print in the record. And 1971 would be a big year for a couple of other reasons for Leon. At the age of 54, Leon became a father again, and the Northwest Arkansas Times announced it in its birth announcement that the baby boy born to Leon and his wife, Eleanor, took place at Washington Regional, what is now Washington Regional Hospital in Fayetteville, and I imagine that's back when it was on North Avenue, North Street. And one other thing happened. Merle Haggard called. Merle sent for Leon, as well as Smokey Dacus, to come out to his ranch near Bakersfield, California, to record a Texas Playboys album with the original band members. So Leon and Smokey, two Rogers, Arkansas residents, headed out to California to make an album with Merle Haggard. Bob Wills, though unable to play, was now in a wheelchair, but he was decked out in cowboy outfit and clutched his fiddle as the Texas Playboys played. While they had a good time, the planned album was shelved. The recording, though, was since labeled as Merle's housewarming party, and it did eventually land on an anthology by the German record label, The Bear Family, and they do great anthologies, by the way. However, forces were in the works to record a Bob Wills album, again with many of the original members, as well as those who came later. They gathered in December 1973 in Dallas, Texas, where Bob Wills now lived. Again, Wills' presence provided the energy to get the recording session underway. Merle Haggard begged Wills to be on the session and Wills relented. However, Haggard had a concert and couldn't make it to the first day of recording. And the excitement from that first day of recording exhausted Wills. So he and his wife had to leave the session early. And then overnight, Wills suffered another stroke and went into a coma. And so the next day they had to go and record without him, and they were convinced that he would not last the next 24 hours. And Haggard got there for the second day, but if you just look at Leon McAuliffe's face and just the weight, I think this photo is just really telling of the mood of that session. They made it through the recording session, which resulted in the album Bob Wills and His Texas Playboys for the Last Time. Wills never regained consciousness and died from pneumonia on May 13th, 1975. And an era had officially ended, though Leon McAuliffe kept performing for special dates. Just a few months later, Waylon Jennings had a hit song with Bob Wills as Still King. And a year later, Red Steagall had a hit with Lone Star Beer and Bob Wills Music. There was a movement to keep Bob Wills music alive. Western swing revival bands were always popping up everywhere, such as Asleep at the Wheel and Commander Cody and His Lost Planet Airmen. There was also a television show in the works in Austin, and the producers wanted the first episode of the very first season to be distinctly Texan. They chose Asleep at the Wheel and requested the appearance of the surviving Texas Playboys, including Smokey Dacus too, by the way. They called themselves the original Texas Playboys under the direction of Leon McAuliffe. So Leon was the band's new leader. Whoops. This is an edited take of the performance, but please pay close attention to the audience members who look young enough to be the band members' kids or grandkids even. And they also look a lot different. They have long hair, wearing t-shirts, but they are having the time of their lives. And watch Leon as they applaud after the set is over, because Leon, he seems a little bit taken aback by it all.
Deep within my heart, my rose of San Antonio.
And while it's not evident here, and I have a record album of the entire concert, which is about four times longer than whatever was broadcast on TV, and that applause you just witnessed lasted 35 seconds. And that was at the point where Leon has to interrupt them and say, "I'll tell you what, we're really, really glad to be here on Austin City Limits. And I can't tell you just how you make a bunch of old men, one or two middle-aged men, and one young man feel really good tonight. I tell you what, you make us want to start playing again." So yeah, the original Texas Playboys under the direction of Leon McAuliffe were the first band of the first season of the first episode of Austin City Limits, which aired in early 1976. And of course, the TV show is still in production today. And so the Texas Playboys were back. However, sadly, within a year of performing on Austin City Limits, two of the fiddle players, Jesse Ashlock and Sleepy Johnson, passed away. With Wills gone, as well as the recent losses of the two fiddle players, the group's original five members made a pact. Should any of them pass on, the surviving members of the Texas Playboys would disband the group. With that said, Leon McAuliffe put retirement on hold. And they recorded albums and secured a deal with a major label, Capitol Records, and had a new audience. In 1977, they were nominated for the Best Instrumental Group of the Year. They were nominated for Best Instrumental Group of the Year Award by the Country Music Association, which is the biggest award ceremony for country music, and it's always televised each year. For Best Instrumental Group, the Texas Playboys had tough competition. Also nominated were Asleep at the Wheel, Charlie Daniels Band, Danny Davis and the Nashville Brass, and the Marshall Tucker Band. And guess who got the award? And that would be Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys under the direction of Leon McAuliffe. The newspapers reported that Minnie Pearl and Loretta Lynn, who were in the audience, were wiping tears from their eyes. They were so moved by all of this. And then Leon said, 45 years in the business, and this is the first time winning. The award made national news, and a reporter from United Press International paid Leon a visit at his home in Rogers, and there he is right now sitting in his Rogers home, to write a story. And the story featured this photo. If you look close, Leon's still wearing cowboy boots. And I must also note that during the same year, the band received an award from the Academy of Country Music, and that's a different organization from the Country Music Association, and they won the award for Touring Band of the Year. And in 1978, he also became one of the first two inductees of the newly created Steel Guitar Hall of Fame. And if you notice the person that's sitting down, that's Pete Drake. And that's the man I showed you earlier who played on Bob Dylan's records. And I think this is also cool because that's kind of the father of steel guitar standing in the middle. And there's all these people. And I'm sure they were just in total awe of being around him. And something else was going on in Leon's life. His good friends, rockabilly legend Wanda Jackson and her husband Wendell Goodman, had become devout Christians. And there were big influences on Leon's spiritual transformation. He attended church at Emmanuel Baptist in Rogers, along with his buddy, Smokey Dacus. And imagine going to church with two of the original Texas Playboys. He also was now performing gospel music, even sharing the stage with Wanda Jackson, as shown in this advertisement here. And Leon was back in the movie business. The Texas Playboys were called to help out with the 1984 film Places in the Heart, starring Sally Field. And that's the one where she received the Academy Award and famously said, "You like me." Set in the 1930s, they provided music for the soundtrack along with Doc and Merle Watson, and even appeared very briefly in a dance scene. The music was a hit. The movie was a hit, and as was the music. But in addition to Field receiving an Academy Award for Best Actress, Robert Benton received one as a Best Writer. So this is a pretty important film. And if you look really close, and it's quick, you'll find that Smokey Dacus, who's sitting on the drums on the left, and Leon McAuliffe sitting on the right, made it into the film. And I just happened to notice that the movie is streaming on Hulu right now, so you can watch it and check it out for yourself. And pay close attention to the music, too. So it brings us to 1986, and about 11 years after the Texas Playboys reformed, the band's piano player, Al Strickland, died from cancer. And holding true to their pact, band members decided to retire the band, but not without one final concert, which took place November 16th, 1986 in Fort Worth, Texas. And the lighting on this just casts a really depressing mood. It's just so dark with the shadows, and it just punctuates how sad this was.
This is a special song in Bob's life, because with this song, he created something completely new. He lived in West Texas, out around Turkey, Texas. And he started playing this song at country dances in people's houses with just a fiddle, and they'd dance to it. It had such a beat you could. He did that for a while, made enough money to hire a guitar player, and that was his first band. But he didn't stop there, I'll tell you. He wanted the biggest and the most famous Western band in the whole wide world, and he wound up getting it, I'll guarantee you. He called them Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys.
And as he speaks at the end, I'm not sure if he's laughing or crying, but it's just such a sad event. But as it turns out, this wasn't exactly their last performance. And the next one that they did, which was their official last performance, was televised. And it was for a program called Country Music Legends, which aired on PBS, and it was a limited television series. And the Texas Playboys, on a couple of episodes, backed several famous country music artists of the day, including George Strait and Willie Nelson, who we're going to see in a second, who sang Milk Cow Blues. This clip has been edited, but be sure to watch towards the end of the song as Leon lets out a big yell. I mean, he is going out with a bang, and he's having the time of his life.
Okay, Willie Nelson, what a thrill to get to play for this man. Wow.
And if you don't think I'm leaving, you can just count the days that I'm gone, 'cause you ain't gonna see. You ain't gonna see. And you're going to be wondering where in this world I am gone.
Bill Cowboy.
Thank you all very much. Thank you, Leon, Texas Playboy. We love you.
Now that's how you end a career. However, Leon was about to embark on yet another career, adjunct music professor. By the time he performed with Willie Nelson, he was teaching at the Hank Thompson School of Country Music, a program developed by Roger State College in Claremore, Oklahoma. Leon supported the program so much, he sold radio station KAMO in early 1986 and used the profit to go toward the construction of a recording studio so students there can make demo recordings of themselves. And Leon, however, didn't want any credit given to him for his donation. As a quiet nod of thanks, an instructor stitched notes that contained two bars of steel guitar rag on the carpet squares that soundproofed the studio walls. And you can see that in the background here. While Leon performed with the students and would even take them along for gigs, he didn't teach music, but the profession itself, kind of taken on a fatherly role by someone who had seen it all. They don't realize that every time they step out of the door, there's another stake waiting for them, Leon said in 1987. They don't know to read the fine print. That's how I got my knowledge, getting taken every step of the road. And he would laugh too that he was a high school dropout teaching college. And this clearly had to be a labor of love. It's doubtful he needed the money, especially if you know anything about pay for adjunct professors, especially at a community college. And it was evident that it was a calling for him. He eventually left Rogers, Arkansas, moved to Claremore so he could focus on teaching. And his buddy and former bandmate guitarist, Eldon Shamblin, who also performed with Bob Wills, and he went on to be a backing musician for Merle Haggard later, The Strangers was his backing band. But he also taught at the college. And so that was fun for Leon to be able to hang out with his buddy, Eldon Shamblin. And also another musician he taught there was Junior Brown. And he headlined the Tawnytown Great Festival several years ago, but he's another kind of got a cult following who was teaching there at the same time. So that would have been a really neat school to go to. Leon also served as host for a locally produced TV show to showcase local musicians and those at the college. Here is a short clip of him emceeing.
All right. Welcome to Oklahoma Swing and Country, friends. That music you just heard is by the Baker's Brothers Band, and boy, do they look sharp and sound sharp today. And the wonderful applause you just heard is from a group of folks who are an RV club from all over the state of Oklahoma.
Yeah.
I'll get out of the way, friends, because you're going to be well entertained today. And thank you for tuning us in. We'll see you.
Leon had big dreams for the country music school. Early in 1988, he gave a newspaper interview saying he was planning a big fundraiser to go toward an Oklahoma Music Hall of Fame at the college. And he wanted this to include all musicians, just not country musicians. And he was also going to ask donations from people with Oklahoma connections, like Merle Haggard, who sang about Oklahoma, but he was actually from California. And as also there was Roger Miller, who was from Oklahoma, and Roy Clark, and Gene Autry, and others. But what people may not have known was that Leon was battling health issues, and it got to the point that he was no longer hosting the TV show, and he had been hospitalized in Houston with heart problems. And unfortunately, he didn't bounce back, and on August 20th, 1988, Leon McAuliffe passed away at the age of 71. His funeral took place on Saturday, August 27th, 1988 in Tulsa, and it began at 12:15 p.m. That was the time when Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys broadcast their daily radio show on KVOO. Attendees at the funeral wore Western clothing, and a recording of Bob Wills calling out, take it away, Leon, filled the First Baptist Church of Tulsa along with some of Leon's songs. Wanda Jackson even sang Precious Memories. The surviving Texas Playboys served as pallbearers, and Leon was buried in Memorial Park Cemetery in Tulsa, which is the same cemetery where Bob Wills is interred. And so what was Leon McAuliffe's legacy? In 1999, he was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in the early influences category. Unfortunately, Smokey Dacus was not included, which is disappointing. And in 2011, Steel Guitar Rag was inducted into the Grammy Hall of Fame as Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys featuring Leon McAuliffe, so he gets a shout out. Unfortunately, the country music school in Claremore didn't survive after Leon's passing and was dissolved in 1991. But Smokey Dacus lived several more years and passed away in 2001 at the age of 90. And believe it or not, the Texas Playboys didn't completely disband. In fact, Leon Rausch, who joined the Texas Playboys as singer in the late 1950s, and guitarist Tommy Alsup, who also performed during the Texas Playboys' later years, resurrected the group, which still continues today. Sadly, Leon Rausch and Tommy Alsup, however, are no longer with us. In fact, this reformed Texas Playboys performed recently at Tulsa's Cane's Ballroom. And so they're keeping the spirit of Bob Wills alive, as well as Leon McAuliffe and Smokey Dacus and all the others who were in the band. And it's going strong into the 21st century. And so that's the end of my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sandra. We've got a little time for a couple of questions. If
anybody
wants to post any questions.
Can I look at them? Okay, I see them.
You are more than welcome.
Okay, I'm looking at them, and let's see. Thank you, Alan Cheney. Go, Sandra. I think the gentleman is doing you a favor. So, and all right, let's see here. Someone asked, did he ever play at Wonderland Cave in Bella Vista? I don't know that he did. I've never seen any reports that either Bob Wills or Leon played there. He could have, but I don't know of anything. And oh my gosh, we got the son of Al Strickland. That is so cool. Thank you. Thank you, David Strickland. This is so awesome. I don't see any other questions. Are there any?
I'm not seeing any either. Are there any questions?
I have a comment.
Okay.
Leon told me we were talking about steel guitar rag, and he said that he decided at that time it was such a big hit that all you had to do was just write a song and call it a rag, and it would be another big hit. And so he wrote Panhandle Rag, and he took steel guitar rag and turned it totally upside down. steel guitar rag goes da 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 da. Panhandle Rag goes da 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 da.
He is pretty smart for a high school dropout, wasn't he? He was a genius.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
My goodness. And thank you. A lot of people have some kind folks, kind things to say.
May I also say you did an excellent job with your presentation.
Thank you. I ran into some technical difficulties, but thank you.
Well, I can't imagine that you ran into any technical difficulties.
Not a lot of moving parts.
I'll sign off now.
Okay, well, thank you. And thank you, Rachel. Thank you, Chris, for your kind words. And thank you, Rhonda. And thank you, Tim and Kirby and Eric. Thank you, Alan. And I don't know that we have any other questions, do we?
Looks like just a lot of praise for a wonderful.
Well, thank you. I'm surprised, but I'm humbled. Thank you so much. I don't think we talk enough about Leon McAuliffe. And what kind of got me excited about him was learning about all the things he had done after he moved here. I'm ashamed to say I didn't know that he got a CMA award. I didn't know he was in Places in the Heart, or that he was in the first band in the first episode of the first season of Austin City Limits. And I'm like, if I don't know this, maybe some other people don't either, but maybe they do. But it just, and also it was just kind of telling to me, these were older people. These were not kiddos, you know? And that was also inspiring to me that, you know, you can just keep going and do wonderful things.
That's inspirational for all of us.
Yeah, I know, especially as I keep getting older, so yeah.
It looks like we do have a question. Do you have plans to do more work with Leon? And is there a way for Christian to read more about others from this area?
Nice job, Chris. I think he was just kind of, I do have a blog, and I appreciate that, Chris. I did not plant him. But yes, I do have a blog. If you go to echoesoftheozarks.com, and I have a Facebook page, and it can link there, but I have a blog. I actually wrote a lot on Leon about that. That's not included in the presentation. So if you want to read more, a lot of it was in this presentation, but a lot of it was not. So I would steer you in that direction. I've written about a lot of other people who are from this area in the Arkansas Ozarks, and you might find that interesting as well.
Take it away, Leon.